name is Miriam Petruck. I work in the Artificial Intelligence Group at the International Computer Science Institute, which is a closely affiliated institute to the university, but is actually a separate entity. My mission is to tell you about FrameNet. On my way up here this morning, I realized that the FrameNet database was too flat of a title, and the tip of the iceberg came into my head, so I quickly changed the title, because really, in 15 minutes, I could barely tell you anything about FrameNet, though I will be able to give you some basics, and I also hope to whet your appetite so that you'll either ask me about FrameNet or go to the website and find out more about it. We have published tons of papers, and many people in NLP have also used FrameNet. In fact, people in biomedical NLP have used FrameNet. In fact, biomedical NLP, they have a whole conference, and they also have tracks at various computational linguistics conferences, so it's worth looking into. Okay. I thought that coming over here to BIDS and talking about FrameNet, I needed to get some credibility, and so I went back online to find this quote from Michael Jordan on FrameNet. And this was from about 3 years ago. At the end of his interview, the interviewer asked him if he got basically as much money as he could ever want, what would he do with it? And he goes on for a bit. And towards the end, he said, "I'd invest in some of the human-intensive labeling processes that one sees in projects like FrameNet," which, of course, I want to, you know, frame, promote, put on our website, tell the world about it. I mean, if Michael Jordan thinks he could take some of his $1 billion and give it to us, you know, what are we waiting for? Okay, so here are the questions that I'm going to try to give you some answers to today. What is FrameNet? What's in the database? And what's so great about FrameNet? So I've been involved with FrameNet almost since the beginning of the project, which is now 20 years old. In fact, I was involved with FrameNet before FrameNet existed, because I wrote my dissertation on a topic in frame semantics and the lexicon, and it was actually the first dissertation using frame semantics to characterize the lexicon. So even before the founder of FrameNet, Chuck Fillmore, founded FrameNet, I was doing it. Hence, I'm not surprised that I ended up working over there. Chuck Fillmore, the father of frame semantics, founded FrameNet, and he directed the project from its start in 1997 until he passed away in 2014. I have to say that anybody who's worked on a project of this sort or a long-running project knows that projects like these are not one person or two people. They're many people, right? Not a single one of us who has worked on FrameNet or who still works on FrameNet would have had this opportunity but for Chuck Fillmore's work. And so anything that I talk about today, it's not mine. It's everybody's. All the people who worked, even annotators who worked for a semester. And I could spend all afternoon listing the names and telling you what they did and where they are, but we're not going there. So FrameNet is a research project in corpus-based computational lexicography whose product, the data in the FrameNet database, has become an indispensable resource for natural language processing applications. FrameNet is a unique knowledge base with information on the mapping of meaning to form via the theory of frame semantics. And frame semantics is a theory that Chuck Fillmore developed really throughout his career. Actually, I would say he was working on it until his dying day. I think Alex, if I remember correctly, Alex introduced what I was going to talk about vis-a-vis FrameNet, saying that FrameNet was a tool. And I'm not sure I think of FrameNet as a tool. I think of FrameNet as a resource for which we and others have developed tools both to add to the database and to work with the data in the database. So the resource provides rich semantics for the core English vocabulary based on manually annotated corpus evidence. The theory on which FrameNet is based is called frame semantics, and it is an approach to the understanding and description of the meanings of lexical items that assumes that to understand the meanings of the words in a language, we must first have knowledge of their semantic frames. And now I have to tell you what a semantic frame is. A script-like structure of inferences linked by linguistic convention to the meanings of the linguistic units. And here we're talking for the most part about lexical material, though FrameNet also has something to say about multi-word expressions of various sorts. So a frame constitutes a schematic representation of a situation, an object, event, or some relation, and provides the background structure against which words are understood. Each frame identifies a set of frame elements or participants in the situation, in the event, about the state of affairs. A frame comes with a definition, which is a prose description of a situation involving various participants and other conceptual roles, including things like time and place, each of which, as I said, constitutes a frame element. And frame elements are semantic roles that are specific to a frame, right? And then there are lexical units, which we, the definition for which we use is a pairing of a lemma and a frame, that is, a single sense of a word with a frame. Let me give you an example, and because I put this together last night, I decided to use the protest frame. So you see the definition, which I won't read to you. You see some of the lexical units that are defined against this background structure, and there are some canonical examples there as well. So the canonical examples are ones that we made up because we wanted the definition to include really simple, really straightforward examples that anybody could understand what we were doing. And what the FrameNet lexicographer does is presented with a screen of examples for a particular lexical unit in a particular frame. The lexicographer chooses good examples that instantiate the concepts that have been defined for that frame, right? And the FrameNet lexicographer does lots and lots and lots of these annotations, and automatic processes tabulate the results and present them in a format that shows the frame elements, the phrase types, and the grammatical functions of each of the frame elements in the example sentences, okay? And that's where you see the meaning to form mapping. So on the line where you see the number 2 total and we have action, protester, and time, I could click on that link, the number 2, and I will get these sentences, which are probably not legible, but I'll read it to you. So here are the two examples that instantiate that valence description. Oh my God. Hundreds of Muslims have protested the alleged imprisonment by priests of 2 Christian women who converted to Islam. And the frame element is marked in subscript. Okay, so we have done hundreds of thousands of these. I won't go into this example. So FrameNet has more than 1,220 frames, over 13,630 lexical units, approximately 1,800 frame-to-frame relations, which connect the frames to each other and create this hierarchy of frames, which is really a lattice, not a hierarchy, but we started out talking about it as a hierarchy and we just kept the term, but if you look at the structure, it's a lattice. And then we have over 202,225 manually annotated sentences. So again, this was all done manually. And FrameNet really provides the linguistic grounding for information about events, participants, where they happened, when they happened, how, why, who did, the question is always, who did what to whom? Where, when, why, how, okay? I'm gonna skip the FrameNet and sentiment analysis slide, though I will tell you that FrameNet has a lot of information in it about sentiment, and as people yesterday mentioned, sentiment is much more complicated than your, what can I say, standard commercial sentiment analysis engine provides, right? Sentiments are far more subtle and complicated than just positive, negative, or neutral. People are working, someone who studied here in Berkeley and worked on FrameNet for a long time is actually doing a lot of work to develop a more sophisticated annotation for FrameNet for data that records information, subtle information, about sentiment, some of which could, in theory, come back into FrameNet for use on our in our emotion-related frames, or just more generally for a separate, standalone sentiment database. Okay. After Alex introduced, not Alex, Rex introduced himself yesterday as working where he works, and I forgot the name of it already, I decided to, they do peace and conflict studies or stuff like that, something. I decided to pull up an example of some FrameNet annotation that we did for the Center for Nonproliferation Studies. They gave us texts and we analyzed them in frame semantic terms. So everything you see highlighted in blue, of course, is a live link. And you could find out more about that word, its frame, and how it works, okay, by clicking on the link. Okay, so what's so great about FrameNet? The bottom line in natural language processing is and remains who did what to whom, when, where, why, and how, right? FrameNet provides that kind of information in its data. That's what makes FrameNet great, right? Okay, and as I mentioned earlier, lots of natural language processing people have used FrameNet data, are developing great automatic semantic role labeling systems, which I hope we incorporate into our process, and all kinds of research also makes use of FrameNet data. So I encourage you to look at FrameNet. Thank you.